So now we're going to move into a bit more advanced usage of tickle, and that is arrays or associative arrays. So associative arrays are similar to what we would call in Perl a hash, or what we would call a dictionary in Python. There are subtle differences between the things. There's even a dictionary in tickle. It has some sort of a different syntax. It has a similar use case, a bit different, but I tend to use these associative arrays a lot in my procedure writing. It's a way to kind of group together a bunch of similar types of variables and make things a bit more clean, in my opinion, at least when you script things and so forth. So let me give you an example to understand what I mean. Well, let's say we have different courses and we want to have some sort of connection between the course name and the course number. And for example, we'll take the courses that I, some of the courses that I teach at Bar-Ilan University and that you can access online. So I'm going to make a tickle array called courses, and the array is going to have a member called DVD, which is the name that I call my digital VLSI design course, and its number at Bar-Ilan University is 83612. I'm going to make another member inside my courses array of my introduction to VLSI course, and I'm going to call it VLSI, and that's going to be 83313. Okay, so now I can actually access the members of the courses. Well, how am I going to do that? Let's try to put, courses. Will it print everything out? And the answer is no, because it's not a variable. Courses is an array. It's not a variable. Each one of the members of the key value pairs inside courses, it is a variable. So what I can do is I can go put $courses and then dereference, one of the keys inside, and that will return for me the value, which is 83612. Okay, so that's really cool. It's really nice. I can go and group together a bunch of different things with these key value pairs where they're all set in one group that is in this case called courses, and my keys are the course names and the value are the course numbers. Well, I can now do all kinds of other operations on the arrays. So for example, array size, and look over here, you do not use a dollar sign to use this command. You just write array size, no dollar sign, courses, and it will tell us that there are two members in size array. I can also go something like array names, courses, and I will get VLSI and DVD. And I can also do something like array get courses, and it will return a string that has all of these key value pairs that are inside courses. Well, now what can I do with this type of thing? And the usual type of thing that I'm going to want to do is I'm going to iterate over this. So I can do something like for each course name, right? And then I go and I look for array names courses. Okay. And I open up my curly braces and then I like do something like puts, course name. And then I do something like $courses and $course name. And what is that going to do? Let's close our curly braces. It's going to return to me the course name that I got from array names, and then it's going to go into the array courses, use that variable that I got back, and it's going to ask what the value is of it. So it printed out what I have inside my whole array. Well, actually, I can do that with a simpler command as well. Remember that I had this thing that was array get courses. And array get courses return to me, the pairs of VLSI 313, 83313, and DVD 83612. Well, I can use that immediately or inside a for each. So I can do for each, and then I use curly braces and I write the two types of things. So I do the key is going to be course name and the value is going to be course number. And then I do array get courses. What it's going to do, it's going to return, the pair here. So it's going to return course name into here and course number into here. And then I can do something with it. On the next iteration, it's going to go into the second one, course name and course number, and return it. So what I can do now is I can do puts, course name, course name and $course number. And you'll see that that should hopefully work. Yes, it does. Okay, so that's also really cool where I can actually, you know, read out the entire content of the key value pairs in one time. Okay, so I want to show you just before we continue a special array that is called env. So I'm going to go out for a second by pressing Control Z and going out into my desktop. And I want to show you that I have a an environment variable called pwd, which shows where my working directory is. So if I go echo pwd, I'm going to get, you know, this data home Teman AD desktop. Well, I may want to access that from my Tickle shell. And the way I can do it is with the array that's called env for environment variables. So if I look at env pwd, it is going to return to me that same thing. And that can be sometimes useful in all kinds of scripts. Another thing that I can do actually is to execute commands. So for example, again, if I go out into my shell and I write ls, well, I guess I don't have much here, but whatever, I can do make dir temp and then ls, and I see that there's this directory temp. I can go and back into my Tickle shell and I can write this exec command ls, and it will run my the ls command on the outer shell. So those are two very useful things that I can do from inside my Tickle shell. Okay, another thing is printing, and Tickle supports something very similar to the C printf format. We use the format command for that. So for example, I can use the format command, and then I write a string that says something like, you know, $f for a floating point format, and I'll write some sort of a number here, you know, a floating point number, and it will print it out in floating point format with all those zeros behind it. I can also ask it to be in something like an exponential or engineering type of a format. So I write a dollar E, and I'll write again some sort of a number over there, and it will, as you see, have the exponential type of engineering format shown. And I can also do all kinds of other cool things. You know, I'll write format something like, you know, dollar D slash T dollar S, and then I'm going to have here, you know, some sort of a number and then some sort of you know, a variable. And what I'm going to get out of that is it's going to write the number, a tab, and then, you know, the variable here. So it returned a decimal number and then a string, and it printed it out. And that way you can format all kinds of things inside of files and so forth. So now we're going to move over to handling files. So I don't know if you guys remember this type of stuff or have ever run into it from a language like C, but the way you usually deal with files in different file system systems is that you have some sort of a pointer to a file. We call it a file handle. And you usually get that pointer by asking your operating system to open a file for you. And that's what we're going to do here. So we're going to create a variable. We're going to call it file handle, FH. And then what that variable is going to be is going to be the pointer to the file, which we're going to get from a command called open. And we're going to make a file called myfile.txt. Okay. And we're going to open it for writing by putting that W over there. Okay. That is going to return us this pointer that is called file 6. Now, we don't have anything to do with file 6, but we can use, you know, our file handle. So, I mean, we can, you know, do puts on FH, but it's just a pointer to this file that its handle is file 6. Actually, the name of the file is myfile.txt, but it has this handle that is file 6 that we don't know about. It's just some sort of a pointer. Okay, so now what we could do is we want to print to the file. So we can print with something like puts. But puts, it usually is directed to the standard output, which is our screen. If we give it some sort of file handle before we write the actual string as the first argument, then it will write to that file instead. So I can write something like, this is my file, you know, little smiley face, and now it wrote, this is my file, to that file. In order to see if it worked, I'm going to close the file. So close $fh. If I don't close it, I won't be able to look at it through my operating system. I'm going to again go out to my operating system. Now I'm going to do ls. I have this my file over there, and if I look at my file, I can see that it includes this is my file. Okay, so let's go back to our command shell. And now we can do other things. Okay, for example, we can open a file for appending. So again, I'm going to do set fh is going to be open my file.txt with an append on it. So that means it's going to add whatever I do to the end of the file, if you guys have seen this from other languages such as C. And then I can again do something like put $fh, you know, line one, and then put $fh, something like line two, and then I can close $fh. And if I go back and I look at my file, I can see that now it has line one and line two that was appended after what I had already there, which is this is my file. Okay, so let's go back over there. And now let's open our file for reading. So set fh, open my file.txt for reading this time. So it's going to move the pointer, the file pointer, to the beginning of the file, but now it's not going to be able to write on it. It's just going to be able to read on it. So how can I read on it? I can use the get s, the get s command, which returns a string. Okay, so for example, if I do get s $fh, one line, it's going to return to me something, and I can print one line now. That's the name of a variable. The variable is going to be the string that is the first line of my file. Or I can iterate through the file. Now the pointer is already pointing at the second line. It's pointing over here at line one. So I can do something like while, open up another command, get s $fh, one line. One line is the name of a variable. Okay, close my thing. So this is going to return that that line. I'm going to say while it's bigger than zero, because if it's not bigger than zero, I got an empty line, or bigger than, I guess, equal to zero. Okay, then I am going to iterate over everything that's left in the file. I'm going to put, you know, what it says there, $1 line. I'm going to write it out onto the screen and then close my file. And what it's going to return for me is the second and third line, because we already read the first line and our pointer is pointing at the second line. So it returned to me line one and line two. So that's how I can kind of go over a file. Let's close our file. And now just another thing is that I can actually do that whole thing in kind of one step and read it into a variable. So let's do something like that. Set fh again, open my my file.txt for reading, and this reset the pointer to the beginning of the file. Okay, now I can read it in one shot. So I can do set data, and I can use this read command. It's going to read the whole variable fh into the whole file, which is pointed to by the handle that's held in the variable fh, into the data variable. So now I can put $data, and this variable has the entire file content inside it. So that was a short introduction to Tickle. You can do a lot of stuff with Tickle. It's a very simple language, as you can see. Some people, it drives them nuts because it's not as nice and beautiful as things like Python, but it does the trick. Again, I have written many, many, many lines of code in this language, and in the end, you can get them to work. You can scratch your head a lot debugging, but I guess that's true for any language and for people who make a lot of mistakes while they write code, which is like me and like probably most of you. But in any case, it is the backbone that runs, you know, the shell commands in many of the languages that we use. So I do recommend that you get used to it. And there's a lot of material out there on the web that can help you. And of course, you know, Stack Overflow or all kinds of, you know, wikis and just people who put stuff on the web can help you get through things. But I gave you a pretty broad, you know, basis of how to use Tickle and how to start to understand and write scripts that you'll be using with different EDA tools. So that's all for now. Thank you, and until next time.